Welcome to Sharing Knowledge, presented by St. John's University. I'm Bobby Gempisau, President of St. John's. Catholic, Vincentian, Metropolitan, and Global, St. John's University currently enrolls more than 20,000 students. For 146 years, St. John's has fostered student success, and our graduates are uniquely prepared to meet the challenges of a global society. Join us today as we explore shaping the future of learning with our guests, Jean Shannon, a proud alumna of St. John's and assistant principal, St. Elizabeth Catholic Academy in Ozone Park, New York, and Dr. Sharon C., professor of clinical health sciences in the College of Pharmacy and Health Sciences here at St. John's. On this edition of Sharing Knowledge, we look at how education delivery is changing from kindergarten to college to enhance learning for students in the 21st century. Our topic today is shaping the future of learning with our guests, Jean Shannon and Dr. Sharon C. Jean and Sharon, thank you for joining us in today's edition.
Thank you.
Many have discussed that the way we deliver education today is significantly different than what it was 20, 25 years ago. The research literature has shown that the use of technology can enhance learning, boost student motivation, and allow flexibility in diverse learning styles. Jean, I'll start with you. Can you share with us how technology has changed education delivery at your school?
Sure. I've been at St. Elizabeth for 30 years, and when I started, our technology was a piece of chalk and a blackboard. And now every class has a smart board. We have tablets that our children use. We have a smart table, which is a hands-on piece of equipment for our pre-K classes. We do flipped learning in some classes. We give tests online in some classes. It really has completely changed the way we teach. All of our textbook components, from really kindergarten through eighth grade, have online lessons for the children, online games, online reinforcement and support for children. None of those things were available when I first started to teach.
So I have two quick follow-up questions. The first one is, can you share with us what are the significant learning outcomes you've seen through the use of these new tools?
Well, I think interest, student interest, is a great outcome. I think that because our kids grow up in a digital society, when they come into school, if they leave that behind, it's kind of a letdown for them. And so that when they have the opportunity to pursue their learning online, it's really the kind of thing they do at home as well. They spend a lot of time at home online. And so it's really a continuation of the home life, but I think it makes it more interesting for them.
As many of you know, there is also a major shift in our demographics in the country, and it's very apparent in our region here. And we have many of these students who will become first-generation college students. How has technology bridged that gap?
I think technology has been a great asset to students in that gap. We have students in our school who are their first generation going to high school, that their parents have an education up until the eighth grade. And so for kids like that, sometimes at some point, schoolwork becomes something that's beyond what their parents can help them with. And so they look to the internet, they look to YouTube, they look to online research, and they look to their textbook sites to help them when they're struggling in school, because their parents, while willing and supportive of their education, just don't have the ability to help them. And so in that respect, the internet is a wonderful tool for our students.
Sharon, you have been a pioneer in the use of technology to enhance learning at the college level, particularly here at St. John's University. What challenges do you see at the university level preparing for the influx of these students who are educated in a different manner than most of us have been educated in the past?
One of our major challenges is changing old habits. on the teaching side, where we've gone from Sage on the Stage to really trying to engage students. And many faculty sometimes are hesitant to adopt new technologies and teaching techniques because of discomfort and lack of training. And so many faculty really look for proof of concept before wanting to attempt new teaching pedagogies or technologies. So I think training and proof of concept is one of the major challenges I think we have currently.
So let me go back to Jean, and I'm going to come back with you with a question. So Jean, it's easy to talk about the use of technology to enhance learning. The more difficult part is actually applying it. Do you provide assistance to your teachers and so they can effectively use these new technology tools?
So we do provide some assistance. We have, when a new program is adopted in school, most publishers will come and provide support for teachers learning how to use the program to its best advantage. But also, the diocese hosts technology conference once a year. We encourage our children, our teachers to go. In January, our whole faculty will attend a professional development where some of the topics will be technology, not all of them. And we have a requirement in our diocese to have professional development, 90 hours of professional development within every 5 years. And so it is really a professional responsibility to make sure that's done. And so we provide opportunities, the diocese provides opportunities, and then teachers sometimes find their own things to attend, and we will pay for them to go because we believe that that enhances our school curriculum.
So Sharon, how do we engage faculty to be part of this technology enhancing learning initiative? Do we start by engaging them in defining what technology should be placed in the classroom, or do we provide faculty development? Where do we start?
Well, I think one thing we have to define, we have to understand that technology is different than the pedagogy. And we need to make sure that we explain that those are two separate things. So we can have all the technology, but if we're not trained and understand what's the objective of why we're using it, that needs to really be clear.
Do we start by asking them what technology we should put in the classroom, or do we provide technical training in the use of the technology?
I think you need to do demonstrations. When we piloted audience response systems, we started on a very small scale, and we demonstrated that to the faculty, and they were actually having the hands-on experience of using it. And it's a slow process, but I think they need to see examples first, and then the training will come later.
Jean, how do you see the future of this fast-evolving landscape of learning, where at the elementary, at the high school level, it's changing so fast, but at the college and university level, it might not be apparent that the influx of new students are really learning differently than what it was probably just 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm. I think the landscape, as you say, Dr. Gempisa, is changing rapidly. And so I feel like in the elementary school, we're doing our best to try to prepare our kids for high schools, because now many of the high schools are giving tablets to freshmen, their incoming freshman classes, so that all of their work is on a tablet. All of their textbooks, all of their assignments are submitted through that tablet. And I think we are trying to get our children used to that so that they, when they get to high school, don't have a culture shock. But I think it is hard to keep up with the technology when you're running a school or a university, regardless of the size, because there's so many other factors. There's finances, and your building's infrastructure or your campus's infrastructure. Mm-hmm. And as Sharon said, teacher resistance. And so there are a lot of obstacles in the way, but I feel like as educators, our goal is to move our children forward and to make them work to shape them to be adults who can communicate and work in a very technologically advanced world.
You know, Sharon, at the end of the day, what matters is student learning outcomes. So you have taught, I would say, the traditional way, and you have also taught using new technology, the same subject matter, right? Can you share with us some insights on what you see the differences are in the student learning outcomes from the two approaches that we've used in the past?
Well, for sure, when we use the flipped model concept, where we move content outside and leave room during class for activities, I've seen much more student engagement in that style of teaching, as opposed to me lecturing up on the stage and having passive knowledge imparted to the students. And so that has been a great success, I think, when we flip the model that way. Using audience response systems has definitely increased participation during my class. The clickers allow students to, if they're shy normally, if they wouldn't raise their hand, using a clicker would help those people be anonymous and feel more comfortable participating in the class. And the immediate feedback that comes from the audience response systems really helps both me as the professor understanding what concepts students aren't really understanding, and then I can stop my class and review. And it helps the students see that they're not the only ones that chose answer D, even though D was not the right answer. Mm-hmm. There's comfort in knowing that they're not alone.
So there's a quick feedback.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We will take a short break and be right back with Sharing Knowledge. Welcome back to Shaping the Future of Learning with our guests, Jean Shannon and Dr. Sharon C. Jean, you mentioned the term flip lecture, and Sharon, you also indicated that you have used that approach. So I have a question for you first. Can you explain to our audience, what does flip lecture mean?
The concept of flipped classrooms is where you move content such as readings, any kind of study guides, and you can move that material outside of the classroom, assign it as homework, and therefore you free up classroom time for active learning activities such as case discussions, simulations, or hands-on experiences.
Jean, as in many new approaches to learning, there are always bumps along the road. So have you found students or even teachers who have not adjusted to this new approach of teaching, and how did you meet those challenges?
So we found both. For us, my school happens to be a school where 60% of our people are at poverty level. So not everyone has internet access at home. And so one thing that one of our teachers does, when she assigns, she makes her own videos and things that she puts up on a wiki for the kids to watch for homework. It is the delivery of the content so that when they come to school, they can use that for activities. And so, you know, you can buy a splitter for your headphones, and jack that you can put 5 or 6 sets of headphones into a tablet or a computer, and then those few kids who didn't get to see that learning at home can watch it in school before the activity begins. And so that's one thing. Parents are a little leery of it because they wonder, what happens if my child doesn't get it? Will this teacher teach it in school again? Mm-hmm. And of course, that's a teacher's job. If you see that your children are not responding to what you've presented, that you need to present it in a different way and present it again. And I think anything that's new in education meets with teacher resistance. Teachers, a lot of them feel, you know, this has always worked, why should I do something else? I think that's a very common attitude on all levels. I think it's true on the elementary school level and the high school level and the college level as well. And so I think that, Sharon said before, you have to convince teachers that these things do really work. And so there is resistance on all levels. But I think you have to show patience towards the people who are resistant, and then, but just, you know, gradually and gently prod them along.
One thing I've noticed in higher education is because technology has been shown to enhance learning, there are many approaches that have been used by faculty to use technology. And so I'll mention three or four. One is called gamification, another is called problem-based learning, another is called project-based learning, and lately there is a new approach called evidence-based learning. Are you familiar with one or two of those concepts? Would you care to comment on their effectiveness in delivering education, Sharon?
Yes, the concept of gamification I think is very exciting. I've gone to conferences where I've heard professors who you would start with a score of zero in your class, and in order to achieve an A in your class, you have to achieve, let's say, 2,000 points. And the way to get to those 2,000 points can come from a variety of ways. It could be a project, it could be a paper, it could be an exam, but this concept gives students multiple ways of achieving an A grade. And I think it's a great concept because our whole life is about gamification. My fitness tracker, you know, I get badges every time I reach a certain number of steps. I did a review for TripAdvisor, and I get emails every once in a while telling me how many thousands of people have read my reviews, and there's a motivation for me to keep doing it. And so I think it's a very unique way of changing the way we assess students in the classroom.
Jean, you wanna care comment on those?
Well, gamification I think is a very big deal in the elementary school level. We use a math program from 3 through 8 where the children have avatars, and you gain more items for your avatar the more that you participate and the more success that you show. Also, that particular site, as children reach certain levels, awards them a certificate. You know, a certificate is just a piece of paper, but when those certificates are ready, when the children are notified that they've earned one, they want you to print it right away because they're proud of themselves. And our Title I teachers use a program as well to help kids improve their skills, and there are rewards there, and I think that that is a great motivator for younger children. And I, in my teaching career as part, even though I'm an assistant principal in my school, I teach as well. And so we often start class with a problem, when you had mentioned problem-based learning, because research shows that children who are successful problem solvers are successful in education generally. They can even figure out things they haven't learned yet because they use their problem-solving skills. And so I try to use that approach practically every day, because I think that problem solving develops excellent thinking skills that will serve you well throughout your life.
I find it interesting that you mention avatars, because I have seen schools of education where they do practice teaching with avatars. And the avatars are trained to irritate the teacher and see how the teacher responds to this, you know, students who misbehave in the classroom. I'm going to shift a little bit. We have been focusing on the use of technology and how it can enhance learning. I'm going to shift a little bit to another field, which I call signature experiences. And what are examples of signature experiences which I personally believe can also enhance learning? So I'll cite three. One would be what's known as learning by doing, right? So it could be undergraduate research, or it could be an internship or a field project. So that's learning by doing. Another would be learning through studying abroad, learning how to live in a different culture, learning by seeing how things are done differently. And a third would be something that we do a lot here at St. John's University, which is learning through academic service learning. Can you comment on the impact of these examples of signature learning experiences on the future of learning? Let's start with Sharon.
I think I have an example of two students who've done research with me, and that experience of that one-to-one interaction and working on a major project that that included many other students. These students, when they completed the research, they were able to present it at a national conference. They've never attended, and so they have the ability to network with other students across the country. And now they're getting ready to interview for pharmacy residencies. And so that one experience has completely transformed their career path, which they might not have gone on had they not been exposed to other colleagues on a national level. So I think it's been a really great experience for them.
How do you use signature learning experience at the elementary level?
So for us, we have an after-school social entrepreneurship program for our middle school students. And so the idea of social entrepreneurship is to look for a need in your community and try to think of a way to solve that problem. So we have a group of kids that work with a couple of teachers in our school, high school and college mentors. And they work in teams, and they've all identified a need. Some of ours, the needs they've identified is stress as it exists for the middle schooler, the pollution and the use of plastic water bottles, like what they're doing to our rivers and our oceans. And they're trying to find ways to alleviate that, teaching children to be financially or fiscally responsible. Financial education is one of the group's projects. And so they work on coming up with solutions to help kids their age learn about these things and then find ways to make the situation better. And so we have members of our school board who have contacts at another university in Cambridge. And so we took our kids there last year, and we're going to do so again in April. And that we're going to also have something called a hackathon where they're all designing apps that is related to the project that they're working on. And the students at that school are going to help our students develop an app, an educational app related to the project that they're doing on. So it's really exciting. And our kids get to see a school they may never have thought was in their reach. And you know, after we took that trip last spring, all of the kids, we took 35 kids, all of our kids really wanted to go to that school. And so we will take them again this coming spring, and we'll take them to some of them to Washington, D.C. to present. Some of our kids from that group presented in front of Arne Duncan, the Secretary of Education, last February at an event in Manhattan. And so I think those things do a lot of things for our school, but they give our students goals, and they give them they let them know that things that they may think are out of their reach really aren't. And also they learn about the outside community.
So thank you. We will take a short break, and when we come back, we will have our students asking our panelists some questions. Welcome back to Shaping the Future of Learning with our guests, Jean Shannon and Dr. Sharon C. At this point of our program, we have asked a few of our students to ask our panelists some questions. Let's start with Maya.
Hi, my question is for Dr. C. What do you think the next idea is for the classroom of the future?
I think you're going to see more and more faculty and teachers moving from the sage on the stage, the professor standing in front lecturing, to be more of a facilitator, more of a guide on the side type of person.
And our second student who will ask a question is Stephen. Stephen, please share your question with our panelists.
Hi, yes. So my question is, will the degree credentials still be important in 2025?
Degree credentials will always be important. For example, if you were having surgery, you wouldn't want your surgeon just to have gotten a license to do surgery because he received a certain level on a game, right? Or a certain number of badges. You'd want him to be sure that he knows what he's doing. So I think that there are professions. I think education is a profession where degree credentials will always be needed. I think that somebody in the room needs to know how to appropriately facilitate learning so that our children and our students can achieve their greatest goals.
From tablets to smartphones to classrooms without walls, it is clear that tomorrow's students will experience a radically different and more dynamic and shared learning environment than what we have today. I want to thank Jean Shannon and Dr. Sharon C. for their insights and opinions on the future of learning. And thank you for watching Sharing Knowledge. We'll see you next time.